influence had acted upon me to make me become an artist went back so far, it's kind of hard for me to remember. You know, I think around age 5, I was already drawing and painting and kindergarten and things like that, and they were making exhibits of my work and so forth. Actually, I think they put on an exhibit of my work at UCLA when I was 10. And here's a pastel I did of my father when I was 11. So, and then I was given an opportunity to go to the Art Center School. They appreciated what I did. I had great moral support, but there was no role model. My father was a humble worker, and my mother was a seamstress when she was working. They were great supporters. They had no money. They couldn't help me financially in any way. And he felt, you know, to have his son being an artist was just a real big thing to him. You know, he was really proud of me, and my mother was too. And so the moral support was tremendous. When I was 11 and I was going to art school, they would drive me there at night and wait for me till I was done and things like that. I never forgot it. Well, I had some very, very fine, kind art instructors at Art Center School. There was a gentleman by the name of Stanley Reckless, and I remember he was a kindly elderly gentleman, and the first time I met him, I thought he was kidding me about his name. I asked his name, and he said, Mr. Reckless, and I thought he was putting me on, but that was his name. So he was very kind to me and gave me a lot of moral encouragement. It's not so much the instruction, it was the encouragement. I don't think they were living painters at the time. There were the great artists of all time, like Rembrandt and Rubens and Daumier and people like that that were big influences to me. Other influences later on, Picasso, I don't see how anybody can escape his influence. And then I got into printmaking later and I had other influences. Well, I describe myself as I was kind of starting to tell you as a romantic artist, in the best sense of the word, and not in the old sense of kind of sentimental romanticism, but romantic in the sense of things with a deep feeling and deep meaning, and so a lot of my life experiences, I think, go into that. I didn't decide I was going to be that. That's the way I just turned out. And so influences in the other direction, I had some of those for a while by pure abstract, but I found that wasn't for me, that wasn't who I was. And part of it, I think, happened because being in the Merchant Marine, I never got the GI Bill of Rights, like some of my friends who went to art school right after that. And I didn't know that I wasn't going to get it, but so I think that had a lot to do with my going to Cuba. And so I was kind of searching for what I wanted to do. And so I traveled again, and since I didn't have those influences that some of my friends had of the modern abstract art, I guess in a way I was kind of partially a lost soul, and partially I had to find myself. I must have had a feeling I was going to find Eloisa. I almost had an image of that painting before I went there. I was going to do a painting overlooking the city, you know, and it's kind of like, makes you wonder about visualizing things that you've never seen.
I was a student, an art student, at in my hometown in Trinidad, they had a school called Artes y Oficios that was in an old palace that wasn't used as a palace anymore, but as a school.
She was very, very attractive. And I thought she would make a very, very fine painting. I think the painting took a couple weeks, or at least a week. And so we got to know each other a little bit. And as I say, we were very closely chaperoned. So, you know, there was can only get to know within certain limits. I'd say the highlight was when we went up to the tower and I was doing this painting of her town, Trinidad. And she helped me, carry paints and things like that. And so we still have the painting, I'm happy to say, and, mm-hmm. and it adorns our living room. Oh. The language problem was fairly serious, but not insurmountable. I had studied French in high school. Spanish, you know, I could pick up some of the things, but the custom in Trinidad was if you didn't understand something or if they didn't understand, you repeat it louder.
We also painted a lot of pictures.
Yeah, we did sign language and things like that.
Sharing art had quite a bit to do with our relationship, but also I fell in love really strongly. I don't know, I think we both did, but I'm sure then his being an artist had a lot to do with it. Also, I was used to the boys in Cuba being very thinking a lot of themselves, thinking they were so handsome, and I liked his way of just being himself, and that's it. About Martin's work, I like just about everything. Very seldom I see something, and I always tell him when he calls me in to share what he has done. If I see something, then I think I always tell him my feelings about it. But most of the time, I am just overwhelmed. I like.
She is a very truthful and honest person.
Love his work.
So I appreciate her comments very much.
But I try to be honest with
she
him all the time,
honest.
Because I don't think. I don't think it'd be any good any other way. If I say, oh yeah, that's great, and I have a different feeling, I don't think that would be a good thing. I think his themes and keep coming back in his paintings are something that are just part of him coming out every time, you know, all this, like Don Quixote and Cyrano and all these characters that he paints, I think they are inside of him, himself, part of him. I would imagine then these characters and fail than he paints, and we all have failures, and it will come the time when he'll paint one and made it. It will, the time will come. But in the meantime, he has to get these other ones out there, I believe. You know, you have to kind of dig and dig until you find that.
When I first started using the theme of Don Quixote, I must have been a pretty young fellow. And I guess the theme intrigued me because that was an old guy searching for love, searching for romance, and he had kind of an interesting face. And I liked that he rode a horse, and his environment was interesting. So, you know, it was just a natural for an artist, I thought. But I kept coming back to him. Years would go by, and then all of a sudden I was on Don Quixote again. And the other development of combining him with Cyrano was much later, because I did several paintings of Cyrano, solitary paintings of Cyrano, because he was also a very dramatic figure and a high achiever, you know, fighting 100 men and all that kind of thing. And he also had the dream of this wonderful woman. And so there was kind of a connection to Cyrano and Don Quixote, I thought. Well, the contrast that interested me was Cyrano was successful in his life as a soldier, and Don Quixote was, like you say, a dreamer of a bygone age, really. But Cyrano was also a dreamer when it came to the lady that he was in love with but didn't dare tell. I don't know, just fascinating. But he also had this defect, and that was intriguing too. He had this tremendous defect, and you know, I think sometimes we all have defects, and hidden defects or obvious defects, but he plowed on in spite of that. And I think I tried to show that in all the things I've done of him. His nose is very prominent. So there was definitely an influence, you know, from somebody from Los Angeles is going to be influenced by a lot of the Latin culture and things like that. So I'm sure that there was a connection there too. And eventually, we all went as a family, we went to Spain. And there are photographs of me standing by a windmill with a great big pole that looked like a lance. And it was quite an experience to kind of almost, you know, pretend. And I think that's where a lot of art is boring, because there's not enough of that. But that would be the worst defect I could imagine in my paintings, if somebody thought they were boring. But so I always look for something exciting, you know. I think Icarus is the individual that is very sure of himself, but he fails. He's sure of himself, but he fails. So he doesn't take into all the factions into consideration. Naturally, he doesn't listen to good advice. But the theme that Bruegel did on Icarus, it's a very wonderful painting where it shows all kinds of things going on, and a tiny little Icarus falling into the ocean and nobody's paying attention. And some of mine are kind of like that, where nobody's paying attention to not the personal drama, but the drama that's going on outside of them. So I don't know if I can analyze it more than that. Maybe I shouldn't. You know, sometimes the artist really doesn't have to know what he's doing. He just has to do it. And that's important. I think it's just absolutely part of me. I couldn't imagine not painting. I mean, it just comes naturally to me. As I say, I can't remember when I started. I was a tiny, and when I was a little guy, you know, 5, 6 years old, I felt I'm an artist, and some of these people are not taking me seriously. Nothing has changed, and so that's just part of me. I don't know what else to say about that. But I did find enough people that saw talent and helped, tried to help me. A lot of people did. I think the achievement of my creative life is that I plowed ahead in my own direction. Naturally, I had influences, but I steered my own course, I'd say. And I think if you look around, you'll see of a wide variety of subjects. Whatever interested me in life, I painted. I didn't become a specialist, you know, in any kind of, you know, painted trees or painted houses or something like that. Whatever was out there, I painted. Whatever I was going through. So my work is kind of a autobiography. If you look through my work, you can almost find out what I was going through at the time, you know. And so I'm kind of proud of my achievement that I stayed my own course. And I kept struggling to find my way, to perfect my way of painting, you know.